Final Fantasy VII is an iconic game that has lingered in the collective consciousness of the gaming world for more than 20 years, and is without a doubt one of my favorite games of all time. I think that part of the reason it continues to occupy such a special place in our hearts is its amazing soundtrack, composed by Nobuo Uematsu. Most aficionados of game music are familiar with the final boss theme, One Winged Angel, which employed an actual chorus singing Latin lyrics, something that was groundbreaking and frankly kind of shocking to a console gamer back in 1997. But there is much, much more to the Final Fantasy VII soundtrack than One Winged Angel. A great soundtrack is more than just a collection of unrelated songs. Its individual tracks are often related to each other through motifs, or musical patterns that appear again and again across multiple songs in the soundtrack, contributing to a more cohesive feel and often serving as a tool for storytelling. In this video, we're going to delve deep into the structure of the Final Fantasy VII soundtrack, identifying several motifs that make it more than the sum of its constituent tracks. Some of these connections between songs are obvious, others are more obscure but obvious once you hear them, and still other connections may be so tenuous that it's fair to question whether they're mere coincidence. In any case, I think you'll be surprised by just how many genuine connections we'll find. I should preface this video by saying that I am not a music theory expert. I'm just an amateur musician and composer who has listened to this soundtrack more times than I care to admit. I'm not claiming that this analysis is definitive or completely objective, but I hope it deepens your appreciation of this iconic soundtrack and of Nobuo Uematsu's composing style. So let's get started. Here's a graphic I've made to show how several songs on the soundtrack are connected via shared motifs. You can download this graphic in the description below the video. In this chart, thick arrows indicate definite connections, while thinner arrows indicate connections somewhat less certain and might, in some cases, be chalked up to coincidence. As you can see, there are lots and lots of connections. This is a very densely structured soundtrack. Furthermore, they're not random connections, but can often be grouped into families of tracks that share one or more motifs. For example, the Chocobo family contains all the tracks that sample some variation of the melody that begins like this. We can hear this entire melody in most of the tracks related to chocobos or chocobo racing, making it a good example of a leitmotif, which is a recurrent theme throughout a musical or literary composition, in this case a musical one, associated with a particular person, idea, or situation, such as chocobos. As you listen to these tracks, you'll note that the melody isn't always kept exactly the same. There are often subtle or significant changes in rhythm, key signature, or even the pitches themselves, but the same basic contour of the melody is still intact. Now, it's possible that the Farm Boy track also employs a variant of the chocobo motif, but it definitely doesn't sample the entire leitmotif. If it's there, it's only partly represented and heavily modified, which is why I've drawn a thin arrow rather than a thick one. So that's the Chocobo family. It's very clear why Uematsu used this motif in all these tracks, so that whenever we hear this theme, we think of chocobos. Next, we'll discuss a family of tracks that are connected through a single motif, but don't exactly share a unifying thematic connection like chocobos. This is what I'm calling the main theme family, since its tracks all share some variant of the main theme of Final Fantasy VII. Now, Not surprisingly for a main theme, this five-note motif, and its subsequent melodic line, is used all over in the soundtrack, making this one of the largest families of tracks on this schematic. Of course, we hear it in the main theme of Final Fantasy VII that plays on the world map in the first part of the game. We can also hear it in other tracks, such as High Wind Takes to the Skies. As well as Holding My Thoughts in My Heart. We also hear the theme when stealing the tiny Bronco from Rocket Town. Furthermore, we hear a melody based on this motif when Cloud goes on a date with Aerith, or whoever your Cloud goes on a date with. All of the examples of this motif that we've heard so far are in a major key, and invoke feelings such as adventure, excitement, or warmth. However, by using the same motif in a minor key, Uematsu creates a completely different mood, such as desperation in the track Who Am I? Or a feeling of melancholy contemplation in the track That Day 5 Years Ago. Just in this one family, we can see an example of the many ways a single motif can be molded to suit different moods, events, or settings in the story. Now, you might notice a few arrows extending from outside the family. These are from tracks that I've classified as belonging to either another family or to no family at all, because they're medleys of themes from many families. We'll get to them later. For now, let's check out another family. One that I'm calling the Prelude Sephiroth family. Unlike the main theme family, this one is tied together by multiple motifs, each of which is shared by only a fraction of the tracks. Two of them are first heard in the prelude. For instance, here is the iconic arpeggio that has graced virtually all Final Fantasy soundtracks in one form or another. We also hear this in the theme that plays when you get a game over. And the same arpeggio can be heard in partial form in the background of Chasing the Black-Caped Man. As well as in Anxious Heart, or sometimes translated as Anxiety. The other main motif from the prelude that we hear in other tracks is drawn from its main melody, a four-note excursion around the central tonic note. ¶¶ A variant of this motif is also heard toward the end of Anxious Heart, just before it repeats. Music theory buffs should note that in this case, the central note of the melody is not the tonic, and the rhythm is a little bit different, but the same melodic contour is there. This next part may be a bit controversial, but I'm going to argue that this same four-note motif serves as the basis for Sephiroth's main leitmotif in the soundtrack. This melody involves a very similar excursion about a central note. The crucial difference is to move the third note in the sequence down by a half step. And what a difference that half step makes. It now sounds quite ominous. In the context of Sephiroth's theme, the central note in this melody is usually the dominant or fifth note in the scale, rather than the tonic. Let's hear how it sounds in the main theme for Sephiroth, the track called Those Chosen by the Planet. Note that the Sephiroth leitmotif expands upon the original four-note motif by adding a couple of three-note phrases first. However, they're still drawn from the same three pitches of the original motif. We can also hear this Sephiroth leitmotif in other tracks. The last motif in this family is a descending series of triplet notes that appears in slightly different forms in the tracks Weapon Raid and Birth of a God. Unlike the main theme family, this prelude Sephiroth family appears to be self-contained with little or no connection to other families in the soundtrack. If you can think of any such connections, please mention them in the comments. Next, let's move to an even more complex family, which I'm calling the Midgar Fighting Family. It contains a large number of tracks that we hear in connection to Shinra, battles, and other intense situations, as well as various locations in Midgar. Uematsu often calls on the themes in this family when he needs to convey feelings of danger, unease, strife, despair, or oppressive authority. I'll warn you that several of the connections in this family are fairly tenuous, but in my opinion, they're probably beyond coincidence. First, this seven-note motif occurs in the introduction to the main battle theme of the game, often translated as Those Who Fight. We also hear a modified version of this in Under the Rotting Pizza, which in my opinion is a contender for the best name of a Final Fantasy song ever. You might also notice that this track samples the main theme in part. Part of this motif also appears in the timpani part of Hurry Faster. And I'd argue that the beginning of Trail of Blood is also a heavily modified, partial version of this motif, though that's admittedly a pretty weak connection. Next, we have a motif based on a rising blues scale that is heard with a variety of rhythms in different tracks. For example, in the main melody of the boss battle theme, Those Who Fight Further. The same progression of notes is heard with a slightly different rhythm in the track Lurking in the Darkness. I'd also argue that this motif is connected to parts of the Turks theme and Under the Rotting Pizza, though again, these connections are certainly weaker and open to debate. A very prominent motif in this family is a rising minor scale that serves as the basis for the main leitmotif of the Shinra Company. Although the following connections are a bit weaker, similar rising melodic lines appear in several other tracks. To close out this family, let's look at a motif that's shared between the Mako Reactor theme and Shinra Company, which makes sense in the context of the story. Next, let's quickly visit several smaller families that focus on themes we associate with specific player characters, starting with Barrett. We of course hear this motif in Barrett's theme, in the form of a pizzicato string melody. What you may or may not have realized is that this exact melody is heard in Mark of the Traitor, which is heard when you visit the ruins of North Corel. It's at a slower tempo and the key is different, but the melody is unmistakable. Here, Uematsu clearly made a deliberate connection between Barrett and the ghosts of his past, which is kind of cool. A similar connection is heard between the two themes associated with Yuffie. This is the main melody of Descendant of Shinobi. Now, the very same melody is found in Stolen Materia, but in a minor key and without the swing rhythm. The character Aerith, or Aeris as many of us knew her back in the day, plays a central role in the plot of Final Fantasy VII, so it's not surprising that we hear her theme in more than a few places throughout the game. The opening arpeggios of her theme have become almost as iconic as One Winged Angel. The track Flowers Blooming in the Church is in a different time signature, but very clearly uses the exact same melody. Interestingly, a modified version of Aerith's theme seems to appear in the track Reunion. We also hear a second motif in both Aerith's theme and Flowers Blooming in the Church. Now, it was pointed out to me by a Reddit user that it seems like Judgment Day, the track that plays as you venture down into the northern crater for the final confrontation, uses a heavily modified version of this B theme from Aerith's theme for part of its melody. Cid's leitmotif also gets considerable attention, not only as part of Cid's theme itself, but in tracks that involve the Shinra space program and the rocket launch. Meanwhile, Red 13's main theme has several motifs that are shared between tracks involving Red 13 himself, Cosmo Canyon, or important story moments for him. In contrast, Tifa's theme is almost isolated to a single track. The only reason it receives its own family designation here is that it is also heard in the final cinematic, in the track called World Crisis. That about does it for the character theme families. Now let's round off our analysis by listening to the shared motifs from a few remaining small families of tracks. The last family of tracks I'd like to visit is the Lifestream family, because in my view it really highlights how a soundtrack can enhance the overall structure of an epic story like that of Final Fantasy VII. Now, the very first thing that we see in the game is Aerith's face lit up by Mako energy from a leaking pipe, which is accompanied by a musical motif that begins with these three memorable notes. Now, we hear these notes again at a very important story moment, when Bugenhagen discusses the connections between Mako energy, the life stream, and the very fate of the planet itself. At the very end of the wonderfully ambiguous ending cinematic, we see Aerith's face again, this time as part of the life stream where she is even now working to defend the planet from meteor. And we hear those same three notes. That's just the perfect bookend to an epic story, and it moves me to the verge of tears every time I watch the ending cinematic. One final motif to discuss is the main melody from the opening cinematic itself. This is also heard in the ending credits, once again serving as a kind of narrative bookend, linking the beginning of the game to the end. Now, this might be a little controversial, but I would argue that part of this melody is at least hinted at in the melody of the track Life Stream. Now, there are two tracks that I have not placed into any family because they really are medleys of themes from multiple families in the soundtrack, the World Crisis and Staff Roll tracks. As we mentioned, the World Crisis track samples Tifa's theme. As well as Aerith's theme. Not to mention the three life stream chimes I mentioned a minute ago. In addition, we hear Cid's theme. As well as a reference to the main theme of Final Fantasy VII. Meanwhile, the staff roll reprises not only the opening theme, as mentioned a few minutes ago, but the main theme as well. Although we've seen a large number of tracks with shared motifs, there are also several of what I call orphan tracks that seem to have little or no shared musical content with other tracks. This is not necessarily a bad thing, as it keeps things fresh and in many cases gives particular locations or situations or characters a fairly unique feel. Even for tracks that I've classified as being part of a family for this analysis, there are often original melodies and other unique features that were not discussed in this video. Anyway, I hope I've successfully made the case that the soundtrack to Final Fantasy VII is more than just a collection of separate tracks. It is a tightly composed network of interrelated themes that augment the storytelling in a meaningful way through the intelligent reuse and modification of a set of core motifs that you hear repeatedly throughout the game. I'm sure there are some motifs tucked away in the soundtrack that I've missed as well. I think you'll find that this style of composing is pretty typical of Nobuo Uematsu, and is worth contrasting to the styles of other contemporary Japanese video game composers like Yasunori Mitsuda and Koji Kondo. But we'll have to save that for another video. Well, that about does it for my analysis of the Final Fantasy VII soundtrack. I, for one, am very excited to hear what Square Enix does with the soundtrack for the Final Fantasy VII Remake, as there are signs that they're using a similar approach to compose completely new tracks that incorporate many of the familiar motifs from the original soundtrack in a fresh way. For example, in the Scorpion Sentinel battle theme. If you've stuck with me this long, thank you, and I hope this video has deepened your appreciation for not only this classic soundtrack, but also for the craft of composition, for video game music in general, and for Nobuo Uematsu's composing style in particular. If you'd like to see more videos like this, please subscribe and let me know in the comments, and have a good one.